Ciao, I am Renato Floris, the proud publisher of all the scholarly and entertaining books on Rudolph Valentino and Natasha Rambova by Evelyn Zumaya. I'm here today with Evelyn to talk more about her fascinating work. Ciao, Evelyn.
Ciao, Renato. It's great to be here with you today.
Thank you.
So I'm opening this episode today by posing a few questions to our listeners. Did you know that when Rudolph Valentino died, he was working on a book which he hoped would be the true story of his life? Did you know he was so disturbed by the lies being told about him and the false versions of his life story that he retained a Spanish journalist as the writer who would author his book? Did you know that during the spring of 1926, this writer was often found typing away in Valentino's office in Falcon Lair? Moving on, did you know, dear listeners, that Valentino told this writer he would return from his trip to the East for the openings of The Son of the Sheik within 3 weeks' time, and then devote himself entirely to the completion of his true autobiography? Did you know that despite Valentino's death on that infamous tour east with George Ullman, that this Spanish journalist, Baltasar Fernández Cué, would proceed to complete Valentino's book and publish it in Spanish? And did you know that it would not be available to an English-speaking audience until today? And did you know that it was you, Renato Floris, who would execute this book's translation? So, aha, I guess you all know now. And yes, that book, which Rudolph Valentino himself began in the spring of 1926, is our new book, which is titled The True Rudolph Valentino. And in commemoration of Valentino's birthday, we are dating the launch of this book as May 6th. So, happy birthday, Rudolph Valentino. Here it is, The True Rudolph Valentino by Baltasar Cué, translated by Renato Floris with a foreword by yours truly, which is now available on Amazon. Now, with that announcement, we share this special episode about this fabulous book because there is a lot to talk about, obviously. As I just alluded to, in the months before Valentino died, he decided to do something about the false information being reported as his historical fact. He was very upset about that. And even the autobiography he put his name to, My Life Story, which was published in Photoplay magazine in 1923, according to Valentino, well, it turned out to be a false, studio-generated piece of fiction. Because of this, it was during the spring of 1926, when Valentino met with Spanish journalist Baltasar Fernández Cué and began his project to publish his true autobiography. Now, Cué was then an ambitious screenplay writer in Hollywood, and at the time he was also writing regular articles about Hollywood stars and their movies for the Spanish-speaking fan magazines around the world, such as El Sol and La Pantalla of Madrid, the Excelsior in Mexico, and World Cinema, which was headquartered in New York, and others. Now, Baltasar Cué became part of Valentino's entourage in the spring of 1926. And as I said, work was scheduled to begin in earnest when Valentino returned to Los Angeles. Before he left on that ill-fated journey, he gave Cué some letters and documents, which are included in the book. In addition to this material, Cué would source most of his book from his eyewitness accounts of life with Valentino and his friendships with some of the people in Valentino's inner circle. Now, The True Rudolph Valentino, or El Verdadero Rudolfo Valentino, was published as 10 installments in the Spanish-language movie fan magazine Cine-Mundial from May of 1927 to February of 1928.
The book was never published in English, and yes, I just spent the past 10 months translating it. And this new book is the final result of that work, and I'm very proud of it, as you know.
Yes.
You also worked very hard with me on this project. translating my English into actual English. Huh. And I know you are also very excited to share this great Rudolph Valentino story.
No, oh, I am, Renato. I'm very excited. It's been hard for me to not say anything about this. Cué, of course, did not have Valentino to complete this book, the book he wanted to write, but his witnessing so much and the letters and articles that he was given by Valentino make this an exceptionally important piece of Valentino history, and I strongly believe that.
Okay, I'm going to ask you before you begin here today, what is the single most compelling thing you read about Valentino in Cué's book?
There are so many things that were just stunning to read, but I think the one thing that stood out for me was Cué's casual mention of just how many women Valentino had affairs with. So many women. Cué's first-hand account stands in direct contrast to that god-awful porn fiction written about Valentino's love life, which has and still has zero basis in fact and no documentation. Cué was there, and he reported on this. And yes, I will be reading a few excerpts from the true Rudolph Valentino. Here he writes about the time frame when Rudolph came home from the trip to Europe to promote the Eagle. And this is from page 102, and I quote, "Rudolph was again fully living the bachelor life, and the public often witnessed the accompaniment of a lady actress he might be dating. But the women who would truly gain his attention were, of course, the ones the public did not see. There was one woman one day and another the next. Countless women who disputed the honor of being intimate with him, whether in Hollywood or in the surrounding area, in his house or in the ladies' homes or his friends' homes, in hotel rooms, in cabarets, in his yacht of such sad history. Here, these affairs took place to fill him with joy. But everywhere he was left disappointed, because he was only seeking distraction to mitigate the pain of his heavy heart." End quote.
Are you going to say something about Cué's reference to the sad history of Valentino's yacht?
No, I can't give away too much from this book, because I want people to read it all, every single word. I have waited such a long time to announce your translation of Cué's My True Rudolph Valentino. And I hope now that I'm finally able to do so, I hope listeners will pay no mind to those naysayers, those so-called experts, that team as they call themselves, who refuse to acknowledge legitimate research and who identify themselves basically as haters, those ill-informed haters of Ullman, Rambova, Zumaya, and Floris, those who have little good to say or to add to this great body of accurate new knowledge about Rudolph Valentino. I really believe people will reject that continued censorship and the false narrative to soon agree with me that your work, your translation, Renato, is so valuable. Now, this said, I move on. Of course, at the time, the main lady in Valentino's life was Pola Negri, and this is where the eyewitness accounts of Baltasar Cué really excel. I have my opinions on Pola and her presence in this book, but Cué worked with her on this project and interviewed her after Valentino's death. I add that Cué also interviewed Valentino's brother Alberto and a friend Doug Gerard. But Cué's commentary on Valentino's love life stands for me as a testimonial to the truth about this single aspect of Valentino's history, one which has been so ravaged by certain fiction authors out to make a buck exploiting the subject. In their publishing such gross fiction, they are engaging in the same activity which Valentino so reviled and which inspired him to conceive of this book, and why he retained Baltasar Cué to right the wrong of his fictionalization. There are many game changers in this little book, as you well know, Renato, you who spent so much time working through it line by line, your heroic effort.
You say game changers. What thing are you referring to?
Well, one new vantage point I was left with, was it in fact Douglas Gerard who discovered Rudolph Valentino? It is commonly assumed June Mathis was responsible for Valentino's fame by casting him in the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. But would she have even have known about Valentino if it were not for the gallant and prolific Irish director and actor Doug Gerard? And Cué writes, it was Doug Gerard's brother Charles who introduced him to a relatively unknown Valentino. So if one traces the line of Valentino's ascendancy in Hollywood back far enough, the trail begins with a Doug Gerard. What a travesty. I have to say, Renato, that the benevolent sponsorship and professional wisdom of Doug Gerard is so reduced right now to the lowest possible and cheesiest level by that porn fiction writer. But now, Cué's book speaks so clearly about this and really enlightens on Doug Gerard's true role, not only in Valentino's career, but in Gerard's discovering and helping other great stars of the day, John Gilbert, Ralph Graves, and others. And I excerpt the true Rudolph Valentino again, page 53. Cué writes, Douglas met Rudolph at Universal Studios. Rudolph had just debuted as an extra in the movie Alimony. Douglas was a director who had already discovered several artists who became famous, Patsy Ruth Miller, Ruth Clifford, and Monroe Salisbury. The actor Charles Gerard introduced Rudolph to his brother Douglas by encouraging him to cast him in his next film. Then Norman Carey introduced Rudolph to Douglas on another occasion in a restaurant. It seems Norman and Charles wanted to expel the burden Rudolph represented, end quote. Now, you know, Renato, I'm not going to give away more, but Cué relates details of a story where Rudolph Valentino and Doug Gerard compete for the love of a famous movie star of their day. A very amusing little tale.
Cué includes a couple of personal letters in this true Rudolph Valentino, which Valentino himself gave him before leaving for New York City. Two of them were written from Natasha Rambova to Doug Gerard, while she was at Fox Lair Estate in the summer of 1922.
Yes, and these letters are so revealing. I would also say they could be considered a game changer in the story. In one letter, Natasha refers to Gerard's role in her and Rudolph's lives then. And I think pre-Omen, Gerard acted very much as a manager for his protege Valentino. And this is really interesting to read. And for sure, these letters reverse the idiocy of the lies being bandied about in those fictional books about the relationship between Gerard and Valentino. These letters were written soon after Natasha arrived in the Foxlair Estate in upstate New York, just after having been forced out of Hollywood upon the annulment of her first marriage to Valentino. Now, these letters reveal her desperation and emotional state, and it's really a new glimpse, I think, into Natasha and Rudolph's love. And by the way, in one other letter Valentino gave to Cué, in which Natasha writes to Rudy, she signs her name in what appears surely to be his pet nickname for her, which is a very risque revelation indeed. Although Cué is typically horrible in regards to Natasha, dare I say misogynistic, his including these specific letters, they had a kind of exact opposite effect from what I think he was trying to say about her. She is anything but conniving, sly, and aloof. Not at all. I'm going to add here that there is some new history about Valentino's daydreams poems included in those letters from Natasha, too. It's just great.
Alberto Guglielmi Valentino was also interviewed for this book and endorsed it with a letter which is also translated. This endorsement was published with the article in Cine-Mundial. But I think, other than meeting with Cué a few times and knowing him from Falcon Lay in the weeks before he returned to Italy and before Valentino left for the East Coast, I think Cué did not have so much contact with Alberto.
We include Alberto's endorsement of the book with your translation in the new book, and also include your translation of an article Cué wrote about a visit he made to see Pola Negri after Valentino's death, and he went with Alberto. Now, that conversation is pretty revealing, I would say. But as you mentioned, Cué knew Alberto from Falcon Lair, as he was practically a member of the Falconer household during the time Alberto and family were visiting there. So he witnessed events as they took place. And, some of these events collaborate George Ullman's accounts, such as the stories of the turmoil in Falcon Lair, Valentino's love affair with Paula Negri, and much more. I think some of the greatest moments in this manuscript are those personal observations Cué made while just being hanging out with Valentino in Falcon Lair, the vignettes of life, such as this one, which I will excerpt and briefly. And yes, Cué often refers to Valentino as the actor or the artist. And I read from page 147. And I quote, "Valentino, Manuel Ricci, and the one writing these lines, chatted for a long time in his library, as we had on many other occasions. We were seated in front of the portrait preferred by Paula Negri, the work portraying Valentino in the outfit of a Jerez-born gentleman. The actor was in a very good mood, as usual, and his appearance seemed excellent. As always, his strength was apparent. Since he had not yet dressed, he was wrapped in a loose robe, with his dark muscles peering out here and there whenever he moved." End quote. Now, of course, one can only imagine what this book would have contained had Valentino lived and returned to Los Angeles to work with Cué. Now, some of the documents and articles Valentino gave to Cué for use in this book were articles he saved, which demonstrated how painful it was for him to be attacked with grossly fictionalized publications about him. This obviously really scared him, thinking the lies could become a permanent part of his legacy. And I have to wonder what he would think of those disgusting books still being churned out today, which are so fictionalized and completely false.
Yes, those articles Valentino gave Cué, which he pulled from his own files, are sad in many ways, and said that he even had that file and the pink powder puff editorial had not even happened yet. That happened after Valentino left Los Angeles.
It did. Cué does write about Valentino dying in torment over this, and this is something that is well supported in his book. I think Valentino has been tremendously misrepresented, and it is for that reason I am very proud to have contributed to some historical accuracy about him by locating and researching first-hand accounts from people who were there, such as Ullman, Manillo, and now Cué. These are not people who dreamed up some commercial fantastical bullshit based on their own obvious fantasies. These people were there, and their accounts were honestly presented in a dignified manner, based upon their own personal presence in Valentino's life and business. Now, as an aside here, for the record, I personally do not think fiction should be tolerated at all in regards to any real person, especially in historical figures such as Valentino. In the very least, fictional treatment should be always labeled as such and not passed off as fact, with no other documentation other than big fat lies. Who would be happy to have their true life story savaged with lies by sinister people out to sensationalize and make a buck? Historical accuracy matters. I remember Michael Morris told me once that if Hollywood biographies were held up to the same standards as academic biographies, most of them would just have to be thrown out. But it was heartening and sad, as you said, Renato, to learn that Valentino certainly was trying to do something about that situation with Signor Baltasar Cué.
You mentioned that Cué was pretty brutal on the subject of Natasha.
I sure was. I won't deny that. And I addressed some of that in the foreword I wrote for the book. He did not interview Natasha, nor did he know her. And I think his vicious treatment of her is pretty typical of the treatment she was receiving from the press at the time, with this exception being from Herb Howe, say that. But despite this, the letters Cué includes really present Natasha Rumbova in a new light for me. She is revealed as a very emotional woman with a deep love and attraction for Valentino, and suffering in her enforced separation during that summer of 1922. One can sense her panic at the thought of being separated from Rudy for any length of time. She seems frantic to return to him in Los Angeles, pleading that action be taken. And I'm going to quote from the True Rudolph Valentino, page 84. This is Natasha writing to Rudy, and I quote, "You do not know how the strain exhausts me. It's so hard. And it seems that I'm going from bad to worse. Instead of correcting myself, despite what I do. Nor does it ever leave me, that fear that this will separate us in the end. If you could hurry up and come before it's too late." End quote. But now to you, Renato. I have to talk about your translation, as it was really something to witness. We lived it for 10 months, and there were many discussions. You know, when you began the project, I thought you were insane. That was just nearly an impossible effort, too much work. And you were frustrated initially because several critical pages of the 10 installments were just missing. You did locate them in an almost unbelievable way, and I will let you tell about that.
Yes. So, from the last two installments were very missing few pages. I did a search online to find a copy of these publications, but I didn't find any. I just found one, the one of January 28th, but the last copy has been sold to some collector and I didn't find one. So I was looking. I also contacted a good friend and helper we have in Buenos Aires. He went in all the possible libraries of Argentina, didn't find nothing. One day, making the search, I found an article written by a professor from Santiago de Chile. And I saw the photo of the installment I was looking for. Say, this is personal collection of the professor Purcell of the university, the Catholic University of Santiago de Chile. So I contacted him, and he has been very, very nice. I want to thank him. Mm-hmm. And he sent me the photos of the missing pages. So we had all the text. That's all.
Yes, it was quite satisfying for you to find those pages.
Yes, oh my God.
If listeners look at the pages from the original articles we included in the book, they'll see how laborious it was for you to take those scans and convert them to workable text files before you could even begin to translate it all. I add that I will post those precious missing and now found pages on RudolphValentino.org soon.
Yeah, and it was not so easy to translate Cué Spanish, as you know, because he wrote in a very vernacular language that was popular in the 20s. I had to research many, many sentences and phrases.
Yes, you did. But there were also some great discovery moments, too, when you would call to me to tell me something you'd just read. I want to add, too, before I move on here, that this entire project, the archive of the Cine-Mundial scans, was brought to our attention by our great friend, the London archivist, who wishes to remain anonymous. They realized the importance of this work, and let me say, with the deepest and most sincere gratitude, that they encouraged us throughout this entire process. Now, I know you, Renato, were careful in preserving Cué's writing style as closely as possible, staying true to his original narrative and content. It does not seem that long ago, 1926, when the book was written, but linguistically it was. But I personally love to read the old style writing. It's very lovely how Cué turns a phrase.
Yeah. Another interesting character in this book is Manuel Riach, mm-hmm. Valentino's friend and husband of Valentino's co-star in both The Sheik and Son of the Sheik, Agnes Ayres. We have talked about them in previous episodes. I think Riach was an amusing guy who was definitely a playboy, and he and Valentino were very, very in tune as far as humor and playing like two funny, crazy brothers.
Ricci is an interesting presence in this book, and it's interesting to see Valentino's Spanish-speaking friends and influencers, I guess as they're called today. This is something which Alberto Valentino writes about in his letter of endorsement, which was published in the Cine-Mundial installments, by the way. And we include that letter of endorsement and its translation. And I'm going to read a small excerpt from his letter. This is from page 5 in the True Rudolph Valentino. and I quote, Alberto writes, "Finally, I would also like to express my pleasure over the enthusiasm of the Spanish-speaking peoples towards Rudolfo, a true admiration you have witnessed, and the response you receive regarding the positive reception in those countries where they report a true version of Rudolfo's life. This corresponds to the sympathy with which, as you know, my brother always felt towards those same people. He held affection for them and had a preference for screen roles which represented those nationalities. To these same countries belonged some of his best friends, who are mine too. From a Spanish book came the movie which brought him world fame. From another of the same author, a film was made which many say was my brother's masterpiece, and which he took pride in representing a very popular character in Spanish culture. And as you also know, when death surprised him, he was hoping to bring one more novel of the same language to the screen, again portraying the same character so popular in those nations," end quote. Cué comments how Valentino established himself in a European community of friends in Los Angeles, even citing this as an element in the Polonegri relationship as to why she and Valentino found a common ground. Now, speaking of Polonegri, I think, Renato, there's a new discussion to be had now on the spicy subject of Polonegri and Rudolph Valentino. That one scene, which Cué describes, which took place in Pola's home, I'll say before lunch, will make any Valentino aficionado's hair stand on end. I'm sorry, it's great. But no more spoilers, I promise. Cué was accused, you know, of pandering to Pola, even accused of taking money from her in exchange for her very positive portrayal in this book. And in Cué's article, which is included in the book, titled The Consolation of Polonegri. There are two articles included in this book, and both are written by Cué, by the way. His visit with Polonegri, I just mentioned, and Alberto Guglielmi Valentino, who was there. And another article he also published in Cine-Mundial, titled My Last Visit with Rudolph Valentino. But Pola sure has her day here, and seems to thoroughly know it. But there is an anonymous source, by the way, who was instrumental in bringing Valentino and Pola together, and she was the source who spoke so freely with Cué. Now, I can't wait for the discussions about who people think she is. I think, personally, even though he masquerades her as being Latina, I think it could have been Marion Davies. But Pola becomes a great topic of conversation from this book. And some points in the history just might be changed, as in his account of their courtship and how they met. And I'm just going to read a couple of little excerpts from the book. The first excerpt from page 115, and I quote, "Apart from the natural desire with which they were attracted to each other as man and woman, pride also brought them together. Rudolph had plenty of women, and Pola had plenty of men. But she would take a special pleasure in conquering such a coveted young man. Rudolph, in turn, would feel more flattered with her attention than by any other woman who fell into his arms. This mysterious, magnetic, and ruthless woman, who, although she gave joy to some fortunate men, seemed to delight in tormenting most of them," end quote. And from page 116, and I quote, "At that time, the writer Michael Arlen, author of The Green Hat, arrived in Hollywood to be entertained by the film community. Among his admirers, Polonegri distinguished herself prominently, and she hosted a banquet at the Biltmore Hotel in honor of the writer. When making out her list of guests, Pola hesitated before including the name of Rudolph Valentino, because she feared he would humiliate her by not accepting the invitation. But the aforementioned Latina matchmaker assured her, he will jump for joy if you invite him," end quote. Cué makes a couple of valid points regarding Pola and her motivations towards Valentino. He claims Pola was the wealthier of the two and had no financial interest in pursuing Valentino. Boy, I think that's very true. Just citing as an example of that, in May of 1925, Pola seemed to have some problems with U.S. Customs. When she was found to have had 16 bottles of liquor in her hidden in her baggage. Now, she would blame her maid for that, but I get to my point here. She also failed to declare three pieces of jewelry, a diamond ring, two bracelets valued at $47,000. By today's exchange, that would be worth $611,000. But my point here is that in 1925, she plopped down in cash the $57,000 to pay the customs fee and to have her jewelry released. That was a pile of cash. Today, that would be about $700,000. So she was hardly after Valentino's money, as has been claimed. And I cite that story to Ancestry.com Associated Press file cards. Now, Pola had also had the name in Hollywood. She did not need Valentino's cachet. I think Cué portrays them both as conquerors. And they were a prize for each other, basically. That was the impression I got.
Well, how did the true Rudolph Valentino change your perception of the Pola and Valentino relationship, if it changed?
I don't know if it changed, but it's still a mystery to me on some levels. George Ullman says Pola greatly exaggerated the seriousness of her love affair with Valentino. I think that is possible. It sure is. I also think people jumped in to market themselves on that incredible press coverage about Valentino in the weeks and months after his death. Cué makes us realize, whether he intended to or not, that Pola sure did, in many ways, from her dramatics both at the funerals and in her personal life. But I think she and Valentino were heavily involved, but that neither of them were very faithful to each other. No more said on that for now. But I also found it interesting that Pola Negri really changed her tune on the subject of spiritualism. Now, she granted that interview to Baltasar Cué and Alberto in January of 1927. At the same time, Natasha Rumbova was in the news because she was announcing she was going to publish her revelations, those messages she received from Valentino during the seances. And please, everyone, read that intriguing story in Astral Affairs Rumbova. So, when Natasha spoke about those transmissions from the astral plane, reporters asked her whether Rudy had anything to say to Pola. Natasha replied, no, that he only spoke of worthwhile things. So, of course, Pola responded to this burn from Rumbova and was quoted as saying then that Natasha's claim she received messages from Valentino was, and I quote this from Astral Affairs Rumbova, page 113, and I quote, "Profane and commercial," breathed Pola from her Hollywood castle as she read the messages. "Shocking and profane" were even added as she registered indignation and mayhaps envy. In fact, Pola would intimate that Natasha had been breaking astral confidences. And what is worse and more, Pola was not even mentioned in these astral tete-a-tetes. And I cite that to the article in New York Daily News, December 5th, 1926. What? No movies in heaven. So, it's curious, or not so curious, that Pola Negri begins to compete with Natasha and tells Cué out in Hollywood that she and Valentino engaged in the same activities as he had with Natasha, automatic writing, seances, and that she was also receiving messages from Rudy. So, which was it, I ask? But it's a curious timing in it all, nevertheless. Was Pola competing with Natasha on that subject? After calling her profane to even suggest such a thing? So Pola went on, as we know, to cause more controversy when she married Sergei Midvani in April of 1927. And she certainly stayed in the press over the years, with her even being accused of having an affair with Hitler in 1937. I think her response was classic Pola Negri. She said, "Why, I don't even know the man." Now, I think Apollonia Midvani, a.k.a. Pola Negri, I think she took her relationship with Valentino as far as she could. I know Valentino memorabilia collector Bill Self told me he never managed to get an interview with her, although he tried, because she told him, "Bill, you only want to talk to me about Rudy." And maybe she caused some of that herself.
The true Rudolph Valentino is now on Amazon, and I really hope everyone will enjoy it. It's worth, believe me. We are getting it up to speed. And as always, thank everyone for their patience. And please check out all of other fine books we have worked so hard on.
We have.
We have.
In closing, I'm going to misbehave a little bit here, because I'm going to reveal one other little juicy tidbit from this book, because the image is just so great. Cué writes how friends in New York City reported seeing Rudolph Valentino strolling down the streets of Manhattan with his ex-wife Jean Acker in the weeks before his death. And according to these eyewitnesses, the couple was stopping at one speakeasy after another, and Valentino was not only holding Gene Acker's hand, but pressing it to his lips as he was walking along. The long kissing of Gene's hand. And in the book, Cué reports a prophecy from a Valentino fan. A prophecy which did not come true, and which never will. Okay, so I just want to say in closing that except for those few missing pages which you discovered, which I will post on RudolphValentino.org, all of the Cué book, the original articles, are online in Spanish, so there's a great opportunity for anyone to check the translation and view the original articles as they were first published. We've included some of those pages in the book, but obviously we could not reproduce them full size. And for today, I again thank everyone who supports our work and is so kind to write in with intelligent commentary. And please find, as you said, as Renato said, all the books on Amazon, which are full of great stories and information, which we're eager to share.
So, now, thank you everyone for listening. And as always, I say, fiat justitia, ruat caelum. And for the good guys, read the book and arrivederci!